Hi, today we're going to talk about labor unions and their role in international business. The text does a fairly good job in terms of providing definitions of the different concepts around unions, describing the different types of unions, talking about the history of unionization. What it doesn't do well, in my opinion, is describing why you should care and then what you should do about it. And this is what I would like to focus on in this video lecture. First, why should you care about unions? Well, if you took my Management 301 course, you may remember that when I asked you what factors should be taken into account when you decide what country your business should expand to, you probably remember that the good answers included things like, you know, wages, and then proximity to customers, to suppliers, to materials, trade regulations, import tariffs, export tariffs, that kind of stuff. Political and economic stability. So you obviously want to go to countries where, you know, wages are low so that your employees are not expensive. So where your customers or suppliers or raw materials are close, where there are few trade regulations so that you don't have to pay import tariffs and stuff like that, where it's stable and things of that kind, right? One factor that we didn't consider is labor unions, right? And this is very important. But first, let me show you where labor unions are, and then we'll discuss why it is important, why these numbers are important. There is a thing we call union density. So that's basically what percentage of the people in the country belong to unions, trade unions. And as you look at this graph here, chart here, you will see that it varies dramatically from country to country. In some countries, it may be as low as, you know, 10% or so, and in some, almost everyone is in labor union. So these data are from 2009, but the picture hasn't really changed much. So when you look at the United States, for example, it has one of the lowest unionization rates. Good or bad? Well, that's what we'll discuss today. Now, why unions are important? The thing is that when your organization is unionized, you will have a collective bargaining agreement with your employees or the union. And that document, as well as the union that presents or protects it, will greatly determine or have a huge impact on how you can hire people, how your people work or employees work, how much you pay them, how you evaluate them, how you fire them, or whether or not you can actually fire them. So many of those decisions that you as a manager assume that you are allowed to make, when there is a union, all of a sudden those decisions may not be yours, or at least it will not be so easy for you to do it. Many things that we take for granted, like for example, if I hire you, I should have the right to fire you. Well, if there is a union and there is a collective bargaining agreement in place, those kinds of decisions may be not entirely up to you, or maybe not at all up to you as a manager or company owner. So it is very important whether or not there is a union, because unions will limit your freedom as a manager and owner. Now, here is a question that is likely to appear on the exam, and let's see if you know the answer, if you've been listening carefully to me. So, those of you who are watching the, listening to the video, let me read you out the question. The following is true about union density rate. And the answer options basically ask you about unionization rate in the United States. And let's see if you know the answer. And the answer is, well, obviously, the United States has one of the lowest density rates in the world. Now, let me tell you a few stories about from unionized organizations, a few stories about how managers couldn't do what they wanted to do. Some of you may agree with the management, some of you may agree with the employees. I'm just telling you those stories to illustrate how sometimes it may be difficult for you as a manager to discipline your employees if there is a union at your organization. Now, as you may know, there are laws that are designed to prevent discrimination. You cannot discriminate against people based on their race, religion, sexual orientation, family status, and all kinds of other characteristics in the workplace, right? Now, sometimes those laws are not strictly enforced if your employees do not know how to stand up for their rights. But when there is a union, for you as a manager, it will be extremely difficult to get away with acts of discrimination, regardless on which of these bases. And so let me tell you a few stories. I'm curious what you would have to say or think about them. For example, there is one from Canada. A guy works for a company and does a very bad job. He is constantly drunk at the workplace. He is not doing his work well. And the manager or management is trying to get rid of the guy. Now, one day the manager is in the office and the employee verbally assaults the guy and even pushes him. Not a serious physical assault, but still, you know, definitely too much. The manager takes that as a good case, grounds for termination, and fires the employee. Turns out that that employee is a registered alcoholic. So he's a member of the Alcoholic Anonymous, whatever the name of the organization. He's a diagnosed alcoholic. The problem is that alcoholism is a known disease, basically. And you cannot discriminate against people based on their health condition. The logic behind this is that just like you can't take a handicap, can't tell a handicapped person, you know, get up and walk. The same thing if a person is sick, for example, is addicted to alcohol, that person may not fully control his desire to drink alcohol. And then when the person is drunk, obviously the behavior is also not under the person's control. So the employee makes the case that what he did was the result of his disability, well, alcoholism. And the union backs him up. And surprisingly, the management cannot fire the employee because, yes, it is proven that it's his disability that prevents him from first not drinking and then once drunk from behaving properly in the workplace. Obviously, in cases like this, the people not always get the job back. In most cases, they are asked to leave, but the company offers a generous severance package. And so the union will, if you work for a company that is unionized, and if you are, for example, a registered alcoholic, and you get fired for your alcoholism, you can make the case and the union will fight for you on your behalf, and the management will likely lose or possibly lose. And you may actually get to either keep your job or get a nice fat severance package. Now, another interesting story is that a guy works as an IT specialist, something like network engineer or I don't remember what exactly his position title was, but he was working with computers at a company. And then a new manager comes along and sees that the guy is not doing a very good job and just basically sits there and does nothing. And so she, it was a female manager, asks other IT guys to basically check what the person is doing on his computer. Turns out that he's been watching porn most of the time. So not doing the job, but watching porn. Interestingly, the person who told me this story was Alan Ponick, a professor of management at the University of Calgary, where I did my PhD degree. And so when there is a trade union at an organization, if it's unionized, then any dispute normally goes to an arbitrator. And so it's almost like arbitrators are almost like judges, but they specialize in labor union disputes. And so when this case went into arbitration, then all those porn files and pictures, I don't know, videos, were downloaded on CDs, and Alan, as an arbitrator, actually got them and had to watch them as evidence. But anyway, that's just an interesting caveat, I guess, you know, a job of an arbitrator has its, depending on how you see it, perks or downsides. I'm not sure if, you know, you want to watch that stuff, but, you know, sometimes that happens. So in any case, the organization is unionized, and the employee, upon his termination, makes the case that he's a registered sex addict. And it's not sex offender type of thing. Apparently, one of the addictions is your addiction to sexual experiences. And so that may manifest itself in your desire to have sex or to masturbate or some other acts, I assume. And so he's making the case that, yes, he's been engaging in those behaviors at work, but not because he's a bad employee, but because he's basically disabled. He cannot control his desire. And so, yes, he's been watching it at work, but, you know, for the reason because that's his medical condition. And yes, eventually the union has to back him up, because once there is a union, the union is obliged to protect every employee. It's like devil's advocate sometime, but they have to do it. So you pay your union dues and they will protect you. And so on the paper, or in reality, it's, you know, to give you a fair trial. But sometimes it's not really that it goes far. I mean, the law says that if you are disabled, you are not allowed to be discriminated against you. And so if you have that disability that prevents you from doing your work right, or, you know, not doing certain things, then yes, I mean, you are entitled to protection. And if there is a union, you will receive that protection. And so eventually, long story short, the guy, again, doesn't keep his job, but does get a big severance package and, you know, walks away, which would have not happened, I assume, if there was no union at that organization. Finally, one more story, and incidentally, again, from Alan Ponick. His brother is a banker and works in France, or at least at that time worked in France. He was an upper level manager, not a CEO, but he was a, you know, in the higher echelons of management. And so his bank in France, in Paris, was bought by another bank from, I'm not sure if it was also a French bank or another country, doesn't really matter. The point is here that the bank goes through merger and acquisition, or acquisition, I guess, and then merger. And in the process, the new management decides that they want to lay off some employees. And so Alan's brother, this banker, his position basically is eliminated. He at that time had worked for the bank for about 2 years or 3 years, something like that, or maybe more, but not a long, very long time. But again, according to the collective bargaining agreement, in cases like this, employees are entitled to a huge severance package. And in that case, it was 1 year's pay. And so he basically gets 1 year salary. He finds a job within a couple of weeks, gets a new job, and gets to keep the money. So he's a highly, you know, specialized and knowledgeable expert. And it wasn't difficult for him to find the job, but there was nothing the company could do about it. And the only way they could get rid of people that they felt are no longer needed is to pay them these huge amounts of money. And so in the end, it actually worked out very well for the people who got laid off. But again, if you manage or happen to go into one of those countries where unionization rate is high, pay close attention to what first the laws are, labor laws, but then what the collective bargaining agreements typically say. And so some of your plans may be tarnished by the restrictions that may be imposed on you by the labor unions and the collective bargaining agreements. So these things are extremely important. And even if you are as powerful as, for example, Walmart, notoriously Walmart resists unions every way possible and literally fights them. And when Walmart was trying to expand into Germany, it was up against this challenge of most German retail workers are unionized, and Walmart was trying hard and hugely, you know, investing into not allowing unions at Walmart, and unsuccessfully. So there were talks about withdrawing and then staying with union, and eventually Walmart basically lost and had to, I believe they first withdrew, but then eventually established their presence, but with unions. And so Walmart, as you know, doesn't have a union here in the United States, and the employees of Walmart are making notoriously little, as well as, you know, being often mistreated by the management, but not the case in some other countries where there are unions and where Walmart wants to work and works with unions. Now, a logical question that many people ask after these stories is, are unions bad? Well, it depends. You know, it's one of those things where you stand depends on where you sit. If you are an employee, you sure wish there was a union at your company. Sometimes it is true, management can mistreat you. Your managers can mistreat you. And if there is a union, you have first much more power to stand up to the management and fight. But also the management tends to behave much more employee friendly if there is a union. And it's not always a bad thing, right? I mean, as an employee, don't you wish that your managers took you a little bit more seriously or understood your needs a little bit better and tried to work with you as opposed to exploit you. So if you're an employee, you sure wish there was a union. In fact, if you have any friends who work, for example, like Delta, the airline company, or maybe our teachers, and there is again also a union, teachers union, as well as the Delta is a unionized organization. So you probably hear that they make more, their jobs are safer, they tend to be in a much better position as employees, and that's not a bad thing, right? America is not only companies, it's also people, and you know, if unions make people better off, well, maybe they're not so bad. On the other hand, if you are a manager, then you kind of wish there was no union at your company because, as I said, you will have less autonomy and less authority, I guess, or less power to make some decisions. Most managers, most company owners kind of wish there was no union at their company, but again, it's most. I've heard many successful stories where management and unions work together towards the common goal of the company success. And if they work together, it actually may be a very beneficial, powerful outcome. So if you're a manager and you like, you know, my way or highway, the highway, then yes, you don't want a union. If you are a strong individual who seeks advice and maybe sometimes suggestions, then I suppose union may be perceived as a good thing. I mean, why not? Again, sometimes unions take it too far, but you know, they don't have to. Now, if you are a politician, you kind of again want that people, your constituencies, or you know, people in your country or state or whatever region or district you represent, you kind of wish they were also unionized, because again, unions tend to be pro-employee, and employees are the people who vote for you, but also unions not only are pro-employee, but kind of make employees better off in many cases, and you know, hopefully you want your constituencies to be better off. So in that case, unions may actually be a positive thing for you. Again, it depends whether or not unions will like you personally, because unions are major players in the politics, including, by the way, in the United States, where unionization rate is fairly low, but where there are some very powerful unions like the United Auto Workers or United Steel Workers, those guys have a huge impact on the Washington politics. And so it may be a good thing for you as a politician or a bad thing. But again, if you truly care about your constituencies, about the people that who vote for you, I suppose you kind of wish that there was a union for them. After all, you know, labor unions are the folks who brought you the weekend, who created child labor laws, not created, but, you know, brought about. Overtime pay, minimum wage, injury protection, all that kind of stuff. In the 19th or 18th centuries, before, like, real unions, all those things weren't, you know, unthought of. People worked pretty much, you know, not 24/7, but, you know, 6 days a week, 12 hours a day sometimes. There were really no protection mechanisms in place for the employees, and it was very much, you know, exploitation of the employees by the management or owners of the company. To a large degree, thanks to the union, now the labor relations are much more civilized, and in the long run, it actually may help the company too, because, you know, happier employees work better. And in the long run, everyone may win, you know, just like we know slavery didn't work out, not because, you know, it was abolished or abandoned. Well, obviously, you know, many people had to die for it. There were fights and, you know, we cannot diminish that role. But to a large extent, that horrendous and, you know, bad practice also disappeared because it's just economically not feasible. I mean, people who are intrinsically motivated, people who work because they love their work, people who work because they can and not because they have to, they tend to work much better. And so when you have this mutually respectful relationship, then productivity goes up and everybody wins, both the employees and the management. Whereas when you try to exploit another human being, usually you don't win in the long run either. So that approach is not only deeply immoral, but also not economically effective, right? So unions may have a positive impact here. Now, another question you may ask, so that means that unions are good. Well, the truth is that too often unions and the management see the whole labor relations as a zero-sum game. So they think that the more I get, the more you lose, and the more you get, I by default must lose. And it's not always the case that pi can be expanded, but when they see it as a zero-sum game, all those constant fights, nobody benefits from it. It's just like in the politics, like here in the United States, now you see so much tension and fights between the Republicans and the Democrats that it doesn't seem to serve the country well. I mean, it just seems like every step Democrats take, Republicans criticize and try to, you know, obstruct that kind of development, and vice versa. It's exactly the same thing the other way around. So if the union and the management see each other as enemies that they have to fight, no, unions may actually hurt the organization as well as the larger, you know, society. Also, too often, unfortunately, union stewards or leaders, as they're called, stewards, see their role as not necessarily to ensure a long-term success of the people they represent or the organization that they are part of. But as many politicians, all they want is to be reelected to that position. And so that sometimes leads to, again, rather than seeing a long-term picture, they're trying to fight for today's needs and requests of some of the union members. And again, sometimes those not maybe the requests that the union should be fighting for. Sometimes some employees are really not good employees and maybe the company should get rid of them. And so kind of sometimes it's a difficult question, difficult dilemma. And so the same thing, the management often sees employees not as the most valued asset the company has, but as those, you know, lazy people who want to work less for more money. And again, obviously, some employees are like that, but not all. In many cases, employees are happy to work hard, and as long as, you know, they're treated fairly. And so when the management and the unions see their roles in this kind of distorted way, then unions may actually create lots of problems for organization, for the management, for the employees, for the union members. So sometimes it may be a problem. By the way, kind of an interesting observation. When I was searching for pictures for these slides, you know, like these pictures that I show here on me, right? I was surprised when you type union or labor union or trade union and just go on pictures in Google, 95% of those pictures will be with some kind of fist or with some kind of strike. So it almost seems like the common perception as well as common way of doing things for unions or just about everything that surrounds union is this, you know, aura of confrontation. So it's, you know, we're gonna show you what we mean, you know, all this kind of stuff, very confrontational. And if unions are about confrontation, sometimes it's necessary and it may be a good thing. But confrontation generally, it's a way to maybe bring about a change. But if it's a way of life, you know, if it's a way of doing things permanently, then no, unions may actually be more doing more harm than good. So are unions good then, going back? Well, again, if unions and the management work together, and sometimes that happens, I've actually seen a number of organizations where union and the unions and the management work together, then yes, they can be hugely beneficial. If employees stop seeing unions as a way or as a shield that allows them to get away with bad performance, then yes, unions may be good. If union stewards or unions in general put company interest first, and by company I mean these people that are parts of the organization, if the goal is not to make sure that Joey here will not get fired even though he was drunk at work, but that 50 years from now, 100 years from now, this organization remains strong, and so let's see what we can do. And if it means that Joey has to go because he's not performing so that the organization can be successful and the other 1,000 employees can be gainfully employed and remain competitive in the marketplace, then yes, unions can be good. The same thing, if the management sees unions as, I'm glad that there is a union because I not hear my people all the time, don't hear my people all the time, and the union is this medium that lets me know how my employees feel, how they work, how they live, and that information is valuable for me because it allows me to manage my organization better. So if the management sees it that way, again, it's a good thing. Unions can be good. They don't have to be, they're not always, but in many cases they are and they can. So unions can be good, but again, it depends on many things. There was a very interesting story just about a week ago, actually, here in one of the newspapers in Greensboro. Apparently, many or more and more unions say that they are tired of bad employees or tired of protecting bad employees. This particular story was about the teachers union here in North Carolina. I believe it's North Carolina Association of Educators, the proper name. And so, yes, the headline of the article was that we are tired of protecting bad teachers. So they recognize that some teachers are not good. And so as a union, they are supposed to fight for every single one of them. At the same time, they see that in order to deliver the best education possible for the kids here in North Carolina, sometimes you may need to get rid of bad teachers. And so unions are now trying to be more, as I said, long-term success-oriented, as opposed to making sure that this guy here doesn't get fired today, even though he's not a good employee. Now, at the macro level, and there will be a question about that on the exam, studies show that unions may actually be, I don't want to say benefit the country, but definitely have an effect on the economic cycle. In the countries with high union density, economic cycles tend to be smoother. When there is an economic turmoil, in highly unionized countries, the dive is not as deep. At the same time, when there is an economic boom in countries with high unionization rate, the jump or, you know, the boom is not as boomy. The reason for that is that unions make it more difficult to fire employees. And so when the economy tanks, in countries like the United States, many organizations lay off employees right and left. I mean, once the orders stop coming, why would I want to keep those people? Why would I want to pay them? And so that leads only to, only worsens the economic cycle, right? Because the more people get laid off, the higher the unemployment rate, the demand goes lower, the companies see even fewer orders, even less demand, that leads to even more layoffs, and it's this downward spiral that is very difficult to stop. In countries that have much higher unionization rate, like Europe or, for example, Canada for that matter, that is much more unionized than the United States, companies may not be able so easily to get rid of the employees. And as a result, more people remain gainfully employed, more people receive pay, more people create demand, the companies receive more orders, and so there is no need to lay off so many people. So when you look at, for example, economic cycles in Canada and the United States, you will notice that the United States tend to go deeper when there is a recession, though at the same time tends to go a little bit faster up when the recession is over. And that upward trend is also explained by the same factors. So when you have a union at your company, you probably will not be hiring people so freely, because you know that once something goes wrong, you may not be able to get rid of them so easily. So you think twice before you hire someone. And that sometimes, again, kind of slows down the economic recovery. Whereas in the United States, for example, or countries with low unionization rate, you know, as a manager, you generally don't have a union to deal with. And so you want to hire, you hire. Tomorrow you want to fire those people, you can. So there is nobody who will come and protect them. And so that sometimes, again, I'm not sure if it's a good trend or a bad trend. I guess it's good when the economy is growing. It's bad when the economy is going down. But if you believe that a steady development as opposed to jumps up and down is better, then yes, unionization may actually be a positive thing. Now, here is a question for you that will be on the exam likely. Let me see if I can stop this music. It's supposed to be mystery type of music, but it actually sounds very annoying, so I need to change it for the next class. But anyway, here is a question that is likely to appear on the exam, and so it's basically the following is true about unionization impact on the economy, and that's what we just discussed. And the correct answer obviously is B. In countries with high union density, economic cycles tend to be smoother. No big dives or jumps. Now, it's not only about union strength. It's not only about union density. It's not only about how many people, what percentage of people are in unions. It's also about union strength. There are so many different examples of countries where just about everyone is in a union, but unions don't really make any difference. And at the same time, there are many countries where it's the opposite. Not many people are unionized, but those unions have huge power. I should have probably mentioned at the very beginning that for a long, long time, for many years of her career, my mother was a union steward. So probably the last 15 to 20 years of her work life, she was a union steward. She was an engineer for most of her career, but then the last decade or two, actually, she was a union leader. And so I kind of know how it works very well. I've had a good chance to observe firsthand what a, you know, how a union operates. So, but anyway, in the former Soviet Union and then in the 90s, at the time when my mother was a union steward, in that country, in Ukraine of the early 90s and before that in the Soviet Union, just about everyone was a union member. So unionization rate, density was huge. But unions at the same time didn't really play or have a significant, exert a significant influence on the management. If anything, they were almost like an extension or a branch of management. And so they were, I wouldn't say against the employees or didn't support the employees, but they were more an organization that, you know, more or less on paper, if you want to put it that way, right? The same case you can observe sometimes, like for example, unionization rate is fairly high in Latin America. But again, unions there tend to be not as independent of the management and the politicians, not as influential and not as protective of the employees. But then you go to countries like Germany or France, unionization rate is fairly small, low. But at the same time, those unions are extremely powerful and they have a huge impact on politics, on management. I actually was in Germany for 1 year, almost 1 year with Volkswagen. And so the idea was it was an internship, and at that time I had a business related to cars in Ukraine. So the idea was that I would learn how Volkswagen works. And so I was stationed with different departments for some time, moving from, you know, one to another, all the way to marketing and distribution and car dealerships. But my very first position was with the labor union at Volkswagen. So the person who was my immediate mentor or supervisor, whatever you want to call it, was the union steward at that specific organization. And so I got to see how it works. And so not everyone was a member of the union at Volkswagen, or at least not all the people that I, you know, saw in the offices where I worked. But those few who were in that union there, they had a huge impact on the management. And by the way, as you see, Volkswagen does extremely well in the marketplace. So it seems like unions not always hurt the company. So why should multinational corporations care about unions? Well, as we said, at the branches or subsidiaries in some countries, they may not be allowed or able to make some decisions, or some of the decisions will have to be made in congruence or in agreement with the union, and that may drastically limit what can be done by the management of the company. Also, increasingly, unions or unionization or unions in general increase the risk of litigation. So in many cases, more and more in the so-called developing countries, multinational corporations are sued for HR mispractices and other types of, you know, misbehaviors. And so whereas before unions, international companies could just do not really what they wanted, but in many cases they could, I guess exploit is the right word here, could exploit employees, have them work for nearly no pay, fire them at will, abuse them in many other, you know, ways and respects. So, but once the union is there, it's not so easy to do so, and any of those missteps can lead to litigation. And so multinational enterprises should be much more concerned about this issue, because again, it may have a major impact on their business. In addition, multinational corporations may even be sued at their home jurisdictions on the basis of the mistakes they make overseas. And again, unions usually try to make, you know, sure that even if you are mistreating your employees at a subsidiary in the Philippines, if we are unionized here, we may still bring you to justice. And again, good or bad, well, I suppose, you know, if you're an employee, it's good. If you're management, potentially bad for you. But again, this is the reality, and you have to take that into account when you make your international business decisions. What can you do about unions? Well, your textbook has, you know, a bunch of lists with practices that, you know, you can completely not touch the unions and let them do whatever they want. You can just observe, you can try to work with them, you can try to prevent them from being created, all those kinds of things. But in reality, you know, your choices are down to the following. First, when you decide where you want to relocate your, for example, production facilities or expand to, check if there is a union in that industry, in that country. And so what multinational enterprises tend to do, they tend to go to countries where unions are not common or union density is low. In countries like that, they tend to be able to hire people, you know, for less pay, have them work longer hours, not pay them over overtime pay, and so on and so on. Good or bad? Well, again, you know, if you're a consumer seeking cheaper goods, I guess it's good for you. You know, you get a pair of jeans from Bangladesh for half the price of what they would cost if they were from China, and probably one third of the price of what they would have cost if they were made in the United States. If you're an employee, well, kind of good and bad. I mean, on the one hand, if the company still comes, you will be more protected. On the other hand, the company may choose not to come to your country because of the unionization, high unionization rate. So kind of tricky. And if you are a manager, well, as I said, many companies choose to go to countries where unionization rate is lower. So potentially that may prevent FDI flow into your country. Sometimes, again, M&Es, when there is a union, they may threaten the company or the employees that, you know, if you push me too hard, I'll just go to a different country. And so sometimes they actually do go to a different country once the union is formed. And so some may call it a race to the bottom. Others may call it wise business practices. So, you know, in many cases, your decision or your stand on this issue depends on where you sit. And then finally, multinational corporations tend to be big, powerful, with lots of resources, and sometimes they just try to outlast the workers. If the workers go on strike, or if, you know, there is some other form of confrontation, organizations that are big and multinational tend to be able to get money from other jurisdictions, from other countries, and say, well, you want to be on strike, you go on strike. We're not paying you for that period, and they allow not to pay for that period. Depends on the laws in different countries, but generally, yes. And you want to strike for a year. We're not budging, we're not, you know, caving in. So if you want to stay without a pay, you go. And unlike domestic organizations that usually, you know, have no other way but to deal with the employees, because if employees stop working, go on a strike, then the company basically loses sources of revenue and in many cases just ceases to exist. Multinational enterprises, on the other hand, as I said, you know, if you have operation in 20 countries, problems in one of them, you can live through and you can outlast your striking employees. There are some things also, and again, this is just as an example. In the textbook, you have a series of definitions and you know, concepts related to unions. Like, for example, when there is no union, you may have an employee council or co-termination, those kinds of things. And so I don't want to get into those details. It's non-essential for international business. It's just a different form of union, I mean, of employee organization. But you need to know those definitions for the exam. You need to know the basics of those types of employee organizations. And so here is one of the examples of the slides with the definitions. And here is an example of the question that is likely to appear on the exam. And so this one is work, blank, have the right to receive information and provide consultation relative to many decisions a firm makes. Let's see if you know the answer. And the answer obviously is, these are work councils, right? So, see the text for definitions. Also see the text for the unionization history and types of the unions. I didn't cover that, and I don't think I will include any questions on union history in the exam questions. But the book talks about that, and I recommend you to read it. It's kind of interesting. So it's, again, not necessarily international business per se related, but it's still interesting and it still relates to unions. So I don't want to spend time in this video lecture just too dry to talk about that stuff. Plus, frankly, I don't know really much about union history. I know about how they work now and what impact they have now. So, but yes, if you are interested, that stuff is provided in the textbook. Thank you very much for your attention, and yeah, I'll see you in the next video lecture.